And we're joined by Ian O'Donovan. And today he's going to be taking us through a couple of tracks. Uses Ableton Live, and we're going to just sort of get into the details of how he makes his tracks. Tell us a bit about how you sort of got into music production in the first place.
I suppose it just came from DJing to start off with. You know, after DJing for a couple of years, I kind of wanted to do my own stuff, start making my own tracks. So probably about 8 or 9 years ago, a friend of mine had a copy of Reason, so I just started making drum loops and stuff like that. Then I just basically kept messing around with it for probably like 3 or 4 years. Kind of taught everything myself and just, yeah, basically kept at it, you know, trying new things and all that, and it kind of developed from there.
And did you sort of switch to Ableton at some point or?
Yeah, it got to the stage where I felt like I could make a proper track, but the sounds I didn't think were good enough from Reason, you know?
Yeah.
The built-in synths, so I switched to Ableton. It took me a little while to kind of get the hang of everything, but find the plugins and, you know, it's just an easier workflow and stuff like that, and better sounds with the plugins and that kind of stuff.
And how long did it take from sort of that, you know, initial beginnings to getting sort of your first track signed, and how did you get your first track signed?
Well, the first track that I got signed, I actually made probably like 2 months after getting Ableton.
Right, okay.
So that was, I probably made that about 4 years ago. But what happened was I'd sent a couple of tracks to Lauren Garney on SoundCloud, and at the time it was very kind of small, you know, he listened to everything that was sent to him, which it doesn't really happen now because it's kind of gotten really big and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So I sent him a couple of tracks and he started playing them on the radio and playing them in clubs and stuff like that. And then about, I'd say it was like 3 years ago, he was on Twitter and he said, oh, you know, go to Ian SoundCloud and listen to his music. And Paul then from Psychotron saw the tweet, contacted me, and he was just like, send me some tracks. So I sent him a few tracks, and I'd say it was about a month later, he said, oh, Digweed wants to sign a couple of tracks. I was like, Jesus. And then I think it was that night then, I had Digweed ringing me, so it was kind of a bit surreal.
Digweed a bit of a fan, I'm sure.
A bit what, sorry?
Were you a bit of a fan of Digweed's at the time?
Oh, a bit, yeah. You know, I was kind of more, to be honest, I hadn't really listened to Digweed that much because, you know, they were kind of more that real progressive back in the day. And I used to be into kind of really hard techno and that kind of stuff. So, but I've kind of gone into more in that direction. I think he's gone more techno as well than he used to be.
So you sort of met in the middle.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
And what sort of recent stuff have you got coming out or in production?
Stuff coming out. I have an electro EP on a Wolf Skull, which is it's just out in vinyl now, but it'll be out in digital in a couple of weeks. I have another EP with the Japanese Popstars, which is should be out in the next couple of months, I'd say, which is kind of more underground for them, but it's generally the kind of stuff that I do.
Inflyte with, you got the Psychotron?
Yeah, so yeah, the Inflyte release was just out last month, and a remix with Kirk DiGiorgio as well, so that was great. Loads of remixes coming up in the next few months, including ones for like Collective Term Stress, who I'd be a big fan of as well. So.
And how do the sort of how do you get remixes and how is that sort of stuff happening? Are you sending just tracks to people
Well, usually people will ask you to remix, or the label will ask you to remix.
And do you have a manager that does that for you?
No,
yourself?
Yeah, I just do it all myself. So basically, they'll contact me and. If I like the track, what I usually do is if I really like the track and I think I could, you know, really do something with it, then I'll do the remix. If I really like the track and I think it's good the way it is, I won't. You know what I mean? Because I don't want to. Basically, I think if you're doing a remix, you should try and make it better. What you think you can make it better, you know?
Yeah, sure. And tell us about the tracks then you're going to be showing us today. What's the first one you're going to be looking at?
Right, the first one is probably my best known track, Aurora Borealis, which is on Bedrock. I made it about 2 years ago, just basically on a laptop, with all VSTs, so hopefully it'll show, you know, budding producers that you can do a lot just with a laptop in some sense, you know, you don't need loads of equipment.
Cool, good stuff. Well, I'll let you go through this one and we'll do a bit of question afterwards.
Cool.
All right, so basically, where I started this track from was I had a sound that I liked, just on this Albino 3 synth, which is a fairly cheap VST, but I've actually used it in a lot of my tracks and still do. So I like that sound, so I said, okay, I must do something with that. So I started off with that. You can see that's just like a really basic pattern, and then changing it. So just trying out some stuff like that. Then just adding a simple bass as well. Also, which is the same synth, Albino 3. Sorry, just a simple bass sound like that. So they were the first two elements that I had. So then I was just adding a kick. Fairly simple, so. That's kind of the basic loop where I started out. Just doing that kind of stuff. So then I had that going. So if you hear the start of the track, you've got these congas as well, which, again, just a simple little pattern like that. You can hear them on their own there, just a little bit of delay. Sounds coming in here. So we got some 808 toms there with a bit of a compressor, kind of, you know, pushing them out wider, giving it a bit more bass. Some simple hi-hat sounds. Just kind of building it slowly from there. And here's some more hi-hats coming in. So you can see the automation, you know, drawn in here. It's just coming in nice and slowly, kind of building an atmosphere. There, I've got like two different sets of claps if you hear them there. Just combine the two of those, and then I get another one which is the same clap, just pitched down a little bit. Coming in on every second, or every second clap. And another, basically, this was a clap with this clap with a reverb on it, just reversed. So also have another to add to the original first chord synth. This synth is big, you know, it's just a simple sound. If you hear it without, it's got like a third and a seventh note. And if you hear it without, it's just really kind of bland, you know. So just add a simple chord to that and kind of gives it more depth. And another synth here, which is a Predator, made by the same people as Albino, which is Rob Pappin. Just had a seventh note chord on that, you can see it there. It kind of gives the original sound just a bit of a lift. Then the vocal was originally just like a 2 second. I think this was it here. So I downloaded that from somewhere, I can't remember where it was, just probably like freesound.org or something. You get a lot of random samples that people upload and can be handy to use. So basically from that 2 second little loop, our little sample, I looped one part of it. If I take off the reverb there, you'll hear it. See, it's a little bit rough. It's kind of hard to get, you have to keep messing around. It was kind of hard to get it clean. So, but the reverb really helps with that. And then just a bit of pitch bend on the envelope then to bring it down and reverb on it again. And it's then the track kind of builds up slowly, the same elements again. Like you can see the patterns here, it's just simple, like C every third note. Then up here you're just dropping it down to a G. And the bass is the exact same pattern as that. But with the chord it sounds, you know, kind of fuller, and it sounds like there's more going on. With the second chord synth then, which was actually had a drop down to like a, starting off on a G. So you can hear that chord there. And then compared to the original one. So it's a nice, those melodies, or those keys, you know, C and G usually kind of complement each other. Then basically I had copied the patterns from the original chord synth down onto here, but you can see where I've like little blocks that have moved up a few notes here and there. It's just basically a lot of trial and error, kind of messing around and till it sounds basically, until you're happy with it, till it sounds good in your head. I think I even spent like a couple of days. The track probably altogether took me, I'd say, about a week and a half to make. Not full on, probably, I would guess, probably 20 to 30 hours altogether, because I was just doing bits and pieces here and there. But yeah, so it's a lot of trial and error, just with the melody especially, just moving little bits up and down. And you can see the changes there, just making it as interesting as I could, while still staying in key and, you know, using the right notes and stuff like that. Couple of other piece bits of percussion there, like just rimmed with a bit of reverb on it, and so it's just filtered down basically into the main break, just using that bit of a vocal sample again. So it goes right down and just kind of starts building up slowly. Then for the main vocal section on it, you can see it there. I've looped a much longer section of it. And that just plays out. And I had another channel with just without the start of that vocal section, just so it blends straight in like that. Just drawing pitch bend in, which is like, you know, really simple to do. There's a lot of messing around with that, trying to get it to complement the melody that's going already, you know. And you can see I've probably done this the hard way around. If I looped the vocal for like 2 or 3 minutes, I could have just all had one big block of it and just pitch bend up and down. For some reason, I don't know why, I had it in blocks like that. So at the end of this one, you can see it ends down here. The pitch bend goes right down. So I had to start off the other one in the same place to bring it back up. So you can see it coming down here. Starts off from there. It would have been easier if I had one big block where you could just pitch bend up and down, but I don't know why I did it that way, just the way it worked out, I suppose. Also got this bell sound. If I start there. So if I go back here, it's just a really simple bell sound using Native Instruments FM8. It's like Lullaby. You can hear it, and I've got a bit of a redux effect on it. So you can see it there, kind of filtering down, but it's useful for, it's kind of a subtle, when you hear it coming back up in the build-up here, the redux, it's a useful kind of subtle kind of riser to give it a lift before it kick in. Almost kind of a flanger effect there. See all the different pitch bend views on the vocal there. You still got the chord changes up here. Also, I actually added a third chord synth on that, which was, what was that? An FM8 as well, with a seventh note chord on that as well. It's like string ensemble. That was just to kind of give it the higher kind of pitch for the melody. So you've got the three chord synths, which probably, you know, when you listen to the track, it probably just sounds like one, but it's actually three different synths all kind of combining to give that one sound, which I guess when I started out production, I always thought like it was kind of seamless, you know, it was like one bass sound and one kind of lead and all that, but it always worked out for me that I might have to use like two or three sounds for each element, you know what I mean, to really get it full and all that kind of stuff. Sometimes you can get a really good sound, you know, that'll work on their own. But if you can't and you have like limited equipment, when I made this track, it was basically just on my laptop. I didn't even have a MIDI keyboard when I made this, like, so just drawing everything in and it's not particularly a bad thing, you know, like it can, if you become good at it, it's just as handy, you know. Obviously MIDI keyboards are much better for kind of working out melodies. Even if you can't play, you can just kind of tap around with the keys and it's easier to work out a melody, so it is kind of harder to draw it out like this, but it can be done. And there's a lot of, I always find anyway, there's a lot of trial and error, you know, trying different things, and I reckon a lot of the time if you keep at it, you kind of get the sound you're going for. There's a lot of the time, like, you might be working on a track for a week and it'll sound pretty crap or something, but if you keep at it and like tweaking different things, and eventually it'll kind of come around. And usually I find that, like, if I'm making a track, I'll know what I want to do with it, but for like however length of time, I won't be happy when it's like, it sounds terrible or whatever. And then eventually, after tweaking different stuff, you know, it'll come around and you'll get to the stage where you're just like, okay, kind of happy with the sound, or even give it a break for, you know, a few days or a week and come back to it. And often, like, I've done some tracks where I've done that, where I thought it was, you know, worked on it for a week or two and thought it was really bad, left it off for a couple of weeks and came back. And then I realized, yeah, it's okay, you know, I just needed to work a bit more on it or whatever. And then the other way around, sometimes you think a track is great, you know, you might make a track in one day or 2 days or whatever, and you think it's great, and you come back like a week later and you realize it's shit, you know. So, yeah, it works both ways, but it, for me anyway, I know there's people who, like, a lot of producers can, like, bang out a track in, like, you know, a couple of hours or a day or whatever. For me, I always find it a much longer process. It kind of takes me usually a week. Sometimes I can do a track in a couple of days, you know, but usually kind of a week or something like that to get through it.
And do you tend to sort of work on a track for a couple of days, leave it, work on something else, or would you go solid at a track?
It depends. If I'm really into it, I'll try to go solid at it and try and, you know, maybe get it finished or do everything that I can think of at the time, you know, to try everything I can just to see how much I can do with it or whatever.
And do you ever sort of hit a brick wall and just, you can't?
Yeah.
You sort, like, of need to leave it? Or
I've got probably 50 tracks there that hit a brick wall, you know, and they probably never get finished.
And would you ever go back to some, would you ever go back and listen through?
Yeah, definitely. I do it actually regularly enough. I go back. Sometimes if I think a track's not going to work or whatever, and I'm working on something else, I'll go back through and I might just steal a little bit you know, from something that I haven't finished or whatever, to use that and that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Cool. I was just noticing when you were. Yeah. I think one of the really sort of awesome things about the track was the sort of chord progressions.
Right.
And it looked like you were using sort of quarter as opposed to like playing in individual notes all the time.
Yeah. Well, a lot of the time I would, but I find this chord thing in Ableton. It's just a little. Where is it? Here, you drop it in front of the synth, and you can just put it like. Basically, what usually works are like third, fifth, and seventh notes. It
gives you a sort of minor.
So
chord.
Instead of having to draw them all in or whatever, you just drop that in because it's much easier to do.
Yeah, and do you think that sort of, you know, so you're instead of like playing individual chords for each sort of, you know, chord drop down or whatever, having them on those like three, five, and seven gives you a more techno-y vibe, you know, when you're sort of going up the notes, you're sort of keeping.
Yeah, it can. Yeah,
Or do you do? Is that unique to this track, or do you?
No, I do that a lot. Yeah, I do that a lot. I used to draw them all in Reason and stuff like that. You know, you'd be drawing the chords in. It's very kind of tedious. You know, it kind of takes a lot of time. And you can.
But and do you have any sort of musical background previously?
I did play guitar a little bit when I was like a teenager, probably up until I haven't actually played it in about 14 years, to be honest.
So you could play a few chords and.
I could play a few chords on that, yeah. But yeah.
Do you think that helps, or?
I'm sure it does. Yeah. I'd say it does. Yeah.
And how do you get all your samples? Where do your drum samples and stuff come from? Do you sample other tracks and?
Like most of my kick drums, I'd say actually every kick drum I'd say I've used in a track would have been sampled from another track.
Yeah.
I have a lot of like 808 samples and 909 samples where you're just gonna. I'd say I got them. I remember I got the 808 pack anyway online, which is just like, and there's absolutely loads. It's great. I use it all the time. You know, you got, I don't know, there's probably 100 bass drums there. There's like percussion, claps, cymbals, hi-hats. I think I just downloaded a pack.
And what about your sort of mix down process? Do you sort of separate that from the actual creation process, or you know?
No, I kind of do it all at the, you know, as I'm going through the track.
Mixing as you go.
Yeah. I've found recently I spend a lot more time on mix down, so at the end of a track, you know, I'd be like tweaking the volume of a hi-hat for like 3 hours, you know, and it's kind of. I don't know. I need to come up with a better system. But
and do you have sort of specific mix plugins that we'd use on tracks? You know, saturators and or do you just sort of keep it quite sort of minimal?
No, I don't. I don't really use. I use compressors a fair bit, you know, because you can really kind of widen out a sound or, you know, sidechaining like for sidechaining basses and stuff like that. But generally, no. You know, I wouldn't really use many saturators or limiters or anything like that.
And anything on the mastering chain in this one, or would you just leave that to?
I don't. Like, see, I've taught myself all this stuff, so I've never came across, you know, like putting compressors or whatever on master, so I just do the track, mix it as I'm going, basically, and hope that the mastering guys will sort all that shit out.
And even if you're putting something up, for example, on SoundCloud, or, you know, if you just finished the track, you wouldn't even do a wee bit of mastering to send it on to someone, or?
No, I usually just send them as they are.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just sometimes, maybe sometimes I put a limiter on it just to kind of give it a bit of a boost to the level.
Volume,
but generally, no.
Cool. Would you want to give us a look at the next track here?
Yeah. So the next track I'm going to show you is a remix I did for Japanese pop stars.
And this is coming out?
This is out the end of last year.
Right, okay.
Yeah, so it's on Virgin, and you know, it's kind of a big label. They wanted me. The guys asked me, did I want to do a remix, and I was like, yeah, sure, I'd love to. And then they sent out. It was like 110. It's kind of a pop song, basically, right? Like 110 BPM. And so, you know, they just said, you know, do your own thing. So I was okay, but they wanted me to use. I didn't want to use the vocal at all. I only wanted to like use little snippets of the vocal. But they came back after I had it done, and they were like, you know, our manager saying, you know, can you like put in the vocal?
So and what parts did they give you then for?
They gave me loads of parts. I don't even have them loaded here because I only used two of the original parts. Like the first, this was the original piano part that they gave me. As you can tell, like it's a really kind of slow. Kind of soft song. So what I did with that was I just sampled a bit
So you're sort of creating stabs out of those?
Yeah, exactly. I just cut the stabs and put them in a little impulse drum machine. And then I just added my own one just to give it an extra bit of a boost there, because...
2 seconds. Sorry about that.
Right. And I actually got that... The melody for that was from the vocal itself, which, like, this is the main part of it here. I can never own you, that's wherever deep inside. So basically the piano parts just kind of mimic that a bit.
Cool. Well, I'll let you get the guys talk through the rest of it.
All right, thanks.
Get you a couple of questions in a wee minute.
Okay, yeah, so the piano part was just to kind of copy what the vocal was doing to give it a bit of harmony. We'll go back here. So I actually started off the track then with just a simple, what's it like, tambourine and a little bit of a clap. Had a filter on that, so if you take off the filter, it just filter kind of helps kind of bringing it out. It's a bit more interesting, I think. Some simple shakers there with a filter on it as well to give a higher tone. Again, I use some congas in this, which is like from the 808 packs. I think I downloaded for free. Like, they're just pretty common kind of packs you can download, but they're really good sounds, you know. Again, here I've used Predator. What chord have we got here? Okay, so it's just a saw chord, you can hear. Simple kind of a sound. Again, I've got a filter on that. If you take off the filter, it's just a bit kind of plain sounding, so filter kind of helps it give it a bit more, it's just more interesting, I think, kind of dives in and out. That vocal, which is started off at a different point, and just you can hear some hi-hats there. It's just, again, some of these sounds are like from Axis Virus sample pack, and just, I often even take hi-hats from other tracks, if they're on their own, I'll just sample them or whatever. Just another kind of percussion sound. I think I got that from Reason, as far as I remember. Just to give it a little bit more low end. Got another synth, FM8, which is like just a simple chord sequence sound. So I've just got an arpeggiator on that, which basically gives it the melody. Without that, you can see here, that's the pattern. It's just, you know, really simple, but I use arpeggiators quite a lot. It's just on a 16th note. Very handy for giving it a kind of ripple effect. Bass sounds coming in. I've actually used two different layers of bass on this. So the first one was, I think, it's an Albino 3 bass. So if you hear that on its own, I think that's the pattern there. You can see the little note that I've drawn in over there kind of gives it that kind of lifting sound. also got a compressor on that, side chaining from either the bass drum or just a duplicate of the bass drum that's turned off. So if I have it without that, you can hear it. So basically, for those that you don't know, it's side chain will just to help it not clash with the bass drum. Basically, you can see where the bass drum would be kicking in here, so it just gives it a lift every time the bass drum is out. And then also use the Native Instruments Massive, which I think this sound actually, what's really good about this synth is like you can really build your own sounds. So this is a bass sound that I kind of, you know, tweaked all the oscillators and all that kind of stuff and to get your own sound. It's a bit electro-y, you probably wouldn't use it on its own, but it's just to give that kind of more of a growl to the bass. Whereas with the other bass, if I turn up the filter on this, doesn't really sound great when it's up high, so I just kept that one low and used the other bass as the one for the kind of more high energy sound. So I'll go back there for a second. Okay. String sounds then. A lot of people ask me about what string sounds I use in tracks. I use a lot of different things. Ableton actually has pretty good string sounds built into it, so I often use them. You can see this one is just a single note. You can hear it there. That's a really simple one, but when I get up here, for the kind of string stabs there, I originally had the Ableton ones in. You can hear it doing them, but generally for string stabs, I'd like use Reason. I don't have Reason on this computer now, but you'll hear them here. I just think they're kind of more fuller sounding and kind of warmer. And that's, I think, the basic string sound in Reason, which is one of the better synths, I think, for strings. So then, coming into the break in the track here, is this in the original version that I did. So this was the only vocal bit that I had in it. And then they came back and said, you know, we want more. And then they came back again and said, we need the vocal louder and all this kind of stuff. But I did do a dub version without the vocals and stuff as well. So I didn't think it particularly suited the track, you know. But I don't know, you kind of get away with it. Got some more percussion there coming in. It's just like, it's a simple little shaker sound and a snare drum. And again, I've got this filter on it with the LFO set up pretty high and the rate there, so it's kind of really weaving in and out instead of if I take it off. It just kind of sounds a bit plain and boring, you know, and got some delay and reverb on that as well. Basically, how I'd go about sequencing tracks in general, just coming from a DJ, you know, background, I kind of like to have like about 2 minutes, you know, mixing into the track before it really kind of kicks off, or, you know, give you 2 minutes to kind of work with that's going to be kind of mixable and the same coming out, but, you know, try and make it as interesting as possible. And even though a lot of my tracks are kind of long, I would, you know, most of them are like 8 or 9 minutes, I try to keep them as short as I can, you know. If they're longer tracks, they'll usually have a lot of elements where, you know, it'll need that time to kind of build up and progress and that kind of stuff. But if there's only a few elements, you might, you know, might just do like a 6 minute track or, but another synth in here, actually. It's another Albino 3 one, which I've, in these two tracks I've used a lot. But yeah, I find it very good. I still use it a bit. And a few little bits of effects that you can see them here. This is like a sound that I got from Reason. I think it was one of the built-in sounds as well. Just gives it a nice little touch, you know, on the breaks and stuff like that. Simple reverse cymbal. And a white noise effect as well. Which I'd use like these things, some I'd always use like a little bit of white noise or a, you know, reverse cymbal for the breaks, which, you know, pretty common enough. Tend to just use, for my percussion, just use separate impulse drum machines. A lot of people use the drum racks and stuff in Ableton. I just find it just as easy, you know, to drop a new drum machine in, and you can just throw the effects on as you need them, rather than having to, you know, set all the parameters for effects to use with the send and returns on the drum racks. So, I don't know, it depends on the person, but this just works better for me, I reckon. You can hear here the claps on this. I've got like four different clap sounds there. And a tambourine. So it's like I was saying before, you know, if you layer sounds together, you can get it to sound a lot fuller, or just trying out different things can often, you know, get unexpected results and stuff like that, which I basically do all the time, and that's, you know, how I kind of learn how to produce in the first place. So I think that's about it for that track.
Cool, so we've got a couple of questions here from the internet. James X. Arnold asks, how do you get the most sort of width and full sound in your sort of bass lines? Do you sort of use any width sort of plugins or panning, or do you just sort of use the sort of synth to create the?
Yeah, well, basically you'd use a synth mostly. I'd imagine for those two basses, I probably, yeah. See, like if this one, I've got panned to the, okay, that's actually panned to the right, and the second bass is panned, that's probably wrong. I probably moved that by mistake. I'd say that's maybe panned to the left, you know, so.
Yeah,
if I'm layering sounds like that, I'd definitely pan them out to different spaces. Otherwise, they're all trying to fit in the same space within the mix, you know.
So. And internally in the synths, are you sort of panning oscillators in different ways, or do you just sort of go for the?
It depends.
Do you do a lot of synth programming yourself, or are you picking the patch and just sort of?
Yeah, like you usually try and differ from the bare preset, you know.
Yeah.
I'll usually try and tweak it and make it sound a bit different. And or maybe, you know, if I can just get it to one part of the sound that I'm looking for, then I layer it with another one to kind of.
Are you sort of more interested in, you know, have you sort of picture in your head that you're trying to achieve, or are you just looking for something that sounds cool? You know what?
Yeah, I kind of go by ear basically. So I want keep tweaking it and messing around until it's either what I'm looking for, or until I kind of stumble upon something, you know, interesting that I like the sound of.
Cool, we've got another one from Zuki24. What sort of effects are you using to sort of make the arrangement interesting? Are you using sort of, I think it's maybe sort of spot effects like, you know, risers and sort of crashdowns or whatever, or are you using sort of more effects and automating to sort of create risers? And
yeah, I don't really use risers, to be honest. Sometimes use like white noise, you might just filter that up or something like that. Or you know, like reverse cymbals, like add there, and like, yeah.
So I'm noticing, I think, I don't know if it was this track, it was the last one where you'd maybe just bring the synth filters up at the end of the bar to sort of.
Yeah, yeah.
Create that
of course, yeah, yeah.
Sort of sound.
Yeah, so yeah, you turn all those basically always do that. You know, if you're coming up to, you're building it up, so you're just going to be turning the cutoff filter up on most of the synths usually.
And do you think sort of sometimes the risers can sound a wee bit cheap in this type of music? You know, that you want to keep it more subtle.
I don't particularly. Sometimes they work in tracks, but I don't think I've ever really used. You know, really, I've tried it a few times, and I always end up taking it out after.
Yeah, and both tracks are very melodic. You know, they've both got really nice chords, and I know a lot of people from the Sonic Academy forums stuff have difficulties with chords.
Right.
How do you sort of, is it just a case of trial and error? Does it take you long to sort of come up with the stuff? How do you sort of get started from
the melodies? Usually it's not really I can usually put down a melody fairly quickly. It'd be more the technical side of things that takes me the longest. I don't know, maybe it's from having played a bit of guitar, having a little bit of a musical background that way.
Yeah.
I'm sure it does help, because most of my tracks, the melodies in my tracks that I make are just things that come into my head. Sometimes I start messing around with something, and just change, move a couple of notes up and down here, and you might come up with something good that way, but usually I'll have something in my head and I'll just try and get it down and then work from there.
And is there a particular sort of vibe in your head? Is there a particular sort of emotion that you're trying to convey through the? Do you think that far, or is it just really you're just playing until you get something that you go, oh yeah, that's it?
Go
too far in one direction, go, that's maybe too happy, or is it always moody? How do you sort of go about fine tuning that sort of?
I don't know really. I think you kind of know if it's kind of too happy sounding, you just go no. It doesn't work, but I don't really think about it that way. I just think of, I'll usually have some melody in my head or something like that, and I start from there. It might be pretty basic, but I'll just start from there and try and build around it, and the more you're listening to it, then something else might pop into your head, and you'll just do that. It depends, you can start a track from a lot of different places. Like, you can start off with a little melody, and it kind of builds from there. You can start off with a sample, and it can give you ideas, whether that be like percussion and drums, or it might give you an idea for another little melody or something like that. So I think it's always good to try and start tracks in a different place, because it generally will give you a different workflow, which will give you a different result,
Instead of just starting with a kick and kicking a clap.
Yeah, sometimes that works,
And this one, obviously, there's sort of real interesting chord progressions in it. Did they come from the sort of parts that you were given? Did that sort of, or did you completely write it from on your own?
When I started off, I just started off with from the vocal. So I was listening to the vocal, and then I got the piano parts, basically just kind of copied the melody from that. And from there, I don't really know, to be honest. It just, I can't remember what made me think of doing that particular bass line or, the other chords in it.
And are you sort of, do you get inspired by other tracks? Would you sort of stop production and go and listen to other tunes and come back, or do you sort of separate yourself? I mean, you DJ as well, so you're obviously out every weekend listening to a lot of music, So do you reference stuff when you're in the track or in the studio, where you go, oh, I remember that bass line worked really well at the weekend from that track, or maybe try and make something like
sometimes,
that?
Sometimes I'll take ideas from other tracks, but you really have to try and make them sound different, not to try and copy other tracks and stuff like that. But a lot of the time I'll take, actually a good few of the tracks I've done have taken like the melodic parts from maybe from old songs, like not non-dance music songs,
right.
Be like pop song or whatever, depending, I think it was one track I did, Indigo Eyes, which is on Bedrock as well, the main kind of string lead from that, I kind of based it on Kate Bush running up that hill.
Yeah.
Her vocal part.
Was it this? I think it was maybe the previous track where the bongos sounded like Prince.
Yeah,
Prince
people
track.
People said that to me actually after, but I hadn't.
It
wasn't intentional at all. Yeah, and I was like, shit, I listened and it is. It was pretty much the same, but
much
you know.
Same. Okay, well, we're going to ask get some audience questions. So, Sandra's going to go around and pass you the mic. Has anyone got anything to ask there? Yeah, someone at the front.
I always seem to have problems with my kicks in my tracks. Like, I always start with kicks, but then whenever I build the track around them, they just seem not to fit anymore and I'm never happy with them. Would you have any tips for someone who's...
I actually have that problem myself a lot of the time. I'd usually just work away on a track, but I very rarely end up with the same kick that I started with. So a lot of the time, with this track, with the Aurora Borealis is one of the times that the kick worked for it, you know, because it kind of worked with the congas and stuff. But most of the time, I end up going through all the bass drums, you know, tweaking them and eventually come up with something that I'm reasonably happy with. I do have that problem a lot of the time as well.
And would you...
Tips, I don't know, just find... It depends, like, certain different types of kicks suit different tracks, you know? Like, hold on a second.
And would it stop you in the... would you stop and wait to find the best kick, or would you just sort of go, oh, well, I'll fix that later and I'll crack on with the track?
Yeah, fix it later, you know? A different sound might... encourage you to change a kick at a different stage, so I'll just kind of keep working away, and a lot of the time then I still end up at the end of the track going, what kick am I going to use? So one I use a lot here is this one, it's got a nice kind of crisp top to it, but it's also got a bit of bass in it. I sampled that from, so you see there's bass drum Jones, I sampled that from a track called Jonestown. It was by like EC50 or something from a few years ago.
I suppose, like, you know, when you do sample from a record, you're getting a kick that's, you know, someone else has spent maybe a bit of time on.
Exactly.
I guess he's probably sampled it off someone and they've sampled it off someone.
Probably,
it's probably a 909 somewhere along the line that's just been sort
exactly,
of processed. Yeah. You know?
And like, I have all those 909 kicks there, like different ones, loads of 808 ones as well. But
and do you process your kicks after the fact, or would you just look for a good sample?
Sometimes you process them, like, you know, you might compress them or something. If they're really kind of heavy, a little bit of compression will, you know, kind of widen it out, basically, or give it an extra bit of a kind of top that it might need, you know, because some of the kicks can be kind of dull, like if you're, you know, it's kind of dull. So even a lot of the time I'll use two kicks, like, but... Okay, one second now. So you've got this one here. But see the way I had a second one in here? On the second one then, I'd probably like take the decay off a lot, but that'll give a lot more of a...
So you get the click from
the top. Yeah, that'll get the click from the top and the bass from the other one. And obviously you want it very light.
And do you... You know, if you finish the track, would you bring it out straight away and DJ with it and sort of then check or...?
Usually tested a lot, you know, somewhere along the line,
yeah.
Not always, you know. Sometimes I like to leave it for like a few weeks, just to make sure that when you come back, that they're not crap, you know. Because sometimes you spend a few days on a track and you think it's brilliant, and you come back a week later and you don't like it anymore. So,
cool. You know. Have any more questions from the audience down there at the front?
Okay.
No. Anyone else? Right at the back there.
Hello. What do you see for like the future of dance music? Where does your sound is very distinct now? Where is it going to go from now on?
I've no idea, really, to be honest, where it's going to go. Like, I think at the moment, the melodic stuff probably isn't as popular as it used to be, you know. But I don't know. I think it all kind of goes in cycles, you know. Technology will kind of push certain trends, it always does, you know, kind of in different directions, but I think the same kind of cycles will come around. They'll just be different, it'll just sound a little bit different. I think that's basically the way it's gone for the last 20 years, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the techno sound has maybe evolved in terms of production quality, but it's the same sort of vibe, you know. It has that the same elements in it, really, that
a lot
for the
of
last 10 years, you know.
Exactly. So, you know, it's really hard to tell where it's going to go, because you know, some weird trends always come along and that can really change it. Like, you know, minimal, when it came along and whatever, 7 years ago, it really, like, it totally changed the sound of techno. Techno's a lot softer, a lot slower anyway, for one thing. And, you know, it's not as really hard hitting as it used to be.
And do you ever experiment with completely different genres, or are you really focused on?
Yeah, I've done an electro EP, but that's basically techno anyway. You know, it's just kind of breakbeat techno. So
yeah.
For the moment, I would like to in the future definitely, you know, try some other stuff because just from a creative point of view, to see what you could actually do, you know. But for the moment, I'm kind of happy enough.
Cool.
Doing my thing.
Any other questions anywhere? Yep, Stevie Gart there down the front.
Do you use any hardware synths or is it all software synths?
Yeah, I use a few pieces of hardware. Use a Mofo, which is just basically a bass synth, which is really good. Really nice kind of warm analog sound. And also Nord Lead, which is an older kind of one from the mid-90s, but has a lot of great sounds, you know. And, you know, you can really do a lot with the filters and all that kind of stuff. And a couple of other bits that I borrow from friends and stuff like that, like Korg, Electribe, and bits and pieces here. But it's actually most of the stuff I do is VSTs and plugins and stuff.
And how do you wire? Have you got a mixer at home, or do you wire it straight into your sort of sound card? Are you sampling it? Are you running stuff live as well, or what way do you sort of...
No, just straight through the mixer.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's pretty, it's a fairly simple setup, you know. Well, it goes into my little sound card just so, you know, if we're going back in for recording mixes and stuff like that, but yeah.
And would you resample it then in the project? Or do you just keep it running?
No,
just keep it running?
Yeah.
Cool. Any other questions? Yeah.
Yeah,
how you doing?
I'm working on a collab with this geezer here.
Right.
And I imported all the stems into the arrangement view.
Yep.
And it keeps stopping and starting. And see the wee D in the top right-hand corner?
Oh, yeah, okay, up here,
beside the CPU usage, it keeps, like, flashing orange. And
yeah, that just
starting.
Means
Do you know why it'll be?
What's that?
Do you know what's causing that, or...?
It's CPU. It's too heavy on the CPU.
Yeah, I think the D's for your disk drive.
Disk usage or something, because it's streaming your audio stems. I'm not actually using... It's all audio so far. It's just stems. You know?
Yeah, it shouldn't be affected. Audio should be pretty light on the CPU.
Yeah.
Are you
using a PC or a Mac?
Mac.
Yeah.
Laptop?
Laptop, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I haven't used it on my sound card yet, so it's maybe the problem. Like, I've just been using the internal sound card, like, on the
and
Mac.
Have you loaded all the samples direct onto your laptop, or have you got an external drive?
It's reading them from the desktop of my MacBook, so it is. So.
Yeah, I mean, it should be able to handle
it should be.
15 audio tracks pretty easily. Unless they were sampled at a really high... Did Stevie give you them at, like, 32-bit or something?
16-bit, more now?
They're 16-bit. Yeah, that should be fine. Unless you can... Your buffer size and that's not really going to affect it, is it?
No, it shouldn't do.
Yeah. I'm not too sure. That might be more of an issue for the Mac,
give
people.
Give us a shout on the forums. And
I post on the forum, man. No problem. Cheers.
Sorry.
Any other questions? Got one over there.
How do you sort of get on with EQing? Like EQing your bass and kick?
I basically just go through every sound I usually have, like, and that particular one I don't know, but, like, if I go into any of the bass sounds, I'll just, like, stick an EQ8 onto every sound and just kind of mess around with it till you can try to fit it into the mix, basically.
And what sort of speakers are you using?
Just KRK.
Conscious of sort of leaving space for the kick drum versus the bass?
Yeah,
would you look at a spectrum or anything to sort of determine, or is it all done by ear?
I do it by ear, yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you always try and, if you've got a lot of sounds going at once, you know, try to pan them out and EQ them and, like, really give them their own little bit of space. And even in a lot of tracks, if I've got a lot of elements that I want to use, they end up being longer tracks because I don't like using too much stuff at once, you know, and, like, might have one part here and one part, you know, in the beginning or whatever.
Yeah.
So they don't clash and all that kind of stuff. But EQ-wise, yeah, pretty much.
And so, I know a lot of people would sort of put a sidechain on their bass.
Yeah.
And sidechain that with a kick. Do you do that sort of?
Yeah, I have done on that one, actually. The bass there, if you hear it. So without the sidechain. So if I turn it on, like, I don't really do the real heavy sidechain where it's just coming in and out.
It's more just a mix thing where you're just trying to create that
space. Yeah, you're just giving it enough room so it doesn't clash with the with the kick drum.
And in terms of EQ and the other sounds, are you doing that to sort of create space, or you just, or is that more of a sound alteration? So you're trying to create a sound.
Yeah, I'm trying to create a sound. Like, basically, I'm just trying to create melodies that work together and stuff like that. And for me, the EQing is just a way of making them all fit, you know. So I don't really spend, you know, like if I've just got one sound, I won't be EQing it until I add other stuff, and I'll see how I try and make them fit.
Yeah, and if you sort of had a sound and tonally it wasn't sort of working, would you go for a new sound before you would go to EQ and try?
No,
and
shape
in on it.
Yeah, no, I would try and shape it. Yeah, if it really wasn't, you know, if I was really trying to change it, yeah, maybe put a filter on it, you know, and an EQ, and like really try and shape it around. But I prefer to try and just get a more. I'd probably look for a different sound as well. You know, it depends on the specific sound itself.
Cool. Okay. Any other questions? Yeah, down the front.
It's just another question on mixing.
Yeah.
Whenever you're EQing your kick, would you cut between, say, like 0 to 20 hertz that you can't hear, if you understand? Even if you can't hear it, would you still just cut it anyway, in case if you're playing it in a club?
No, I don't really.
I suppose if you're sampling a kick that's come from another record that's maybe already been mastered, that's maybe already happened at the mastering stage, you maybe wouldn't, unless you were adding EQ on top of that kick, you maybe wouldn't need to sort of do too much to.
Yeah, see, the thing is, like, I don't really worry too much about. I try not to anyway. Like, especially when I started out, I try not to worry too much about the real technical. I was just trying to make tracks,
tracks
that. Yeah, exactly. So a lot of this stuff for me has come later. You know, really EQing every part and all that kind of stuff. I used to do that, you know, at the start. When I started making music, but it is important, you know. So you have to do it. But for me, it's more about building the melodies and, you know, making them work together and all that kind of stuff. And then I really try and, I'd actually love if someone else would just do that stuff for me, you know.
Yeah, send it over to be mixed somewhere.
But, you know, I'm kind of getting more into that side of things as well, so.
Cool. Any other questions? Do you have
I noticed you said that you would send it off to a mastering engineer rather than doing your own mastering.
Yeah.
But before you were signed, did you do your own mastering? And
No. I just sent all those tracks as they were to the DJs. Like, generally, they're not going to be that bad. They're just going to be a little bit low on volume, you know. And as far as, like, I knew nothing about mastering. I still don't really know much about it. So when I was sending those tracks to Lauren Garn, and he was happy enough playing them in, like, you know, big clubs, like MP3s that I'd sent him. You know, okay. I was happy enough with that, so I didn't really worry about it too much. But if I do get my own stuff mastered, I usually send it to a guy in Scotland who does, like, he does a lot of Soma stuff and all that kind of stuff, and, like, he can really.
We've got a tutorial actually coming from him on the site.
Connor, yeah.
What's the company called?
Glowcast,
yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, he's really good anyway. So, like, it does help a lot, you know, if you get. Sometimes you got masters back and the sound has just been terrible, you know, and it kind of make you want to do your own, but I just don't know enough about it, so I usually always get it done by someone else.
Cool.
Otherwise, I don't worry about it.
Any other questions? James, up at the back there, do you have one? Spotted it earlier, not getting away with it.
Who would your favourite producer be at the minute?
What's that, sorry?
Who would your favourite producer at the minute be?
I would say probably Vince Watson. Probably has, I'd say, the three producers that I've really liked for, like, you know, 10 or 15 years. Vince Watson, Steve Rackmed, and D-Tron. And I reckon they're still as good as they ever were, still making brilliant music. There's a few new producers that I like. I really like Satoshi Fumi, this Japanese guy, who's, I actually got him to do a remix of one of my tracks there a few months ago, and I'm remixing one of his now at the moment as well. But he does really, really melodic, kind of deep house to techno as well, so love his stuff as well.
Cool. Another question there, James, in the back.
I would always check my tracks before I finish them in mono. I've noticed sometimes the phasing issues on some of my synths. Is there any ways that you would avoid that or any tips you could give me? To
Is that something you even think about?
No, to be honest, I wouldn't really, you know, pay too much attention to that kind of stuff. I just kind of do them. What I do is, like, when I finish a track, I'll try it on some different systems. Like, I'll try it out in the car or, like, put on an old shitty tape and put it on like a tape player and see if it sounds all right on three different systems. Generally, I think it's kind of good to go, you know. But sometimes you're like listening to the car and like something will be missing, so you'll have to go back and kind of rearrange it.
Yeah, and obviously maybe playing stuff in the club if you're happy that it's working in a club, which is exactly. Maybe main environment, then you're...
Yeah, and sometimes, you know, it'll even work on a few different systems and you play in the club and it'll just be something that won't be right, so you'll go back and change it. But
cool. Any more questions? Sandra, do we have any more from the internet?
Yes, we do. Justin J wanted to know, have you any favourite third-party plugins or reverbs?
Yeah. One second now. So ones that I use quite a bit lately are these Tal Dub and stuff, if I drop that one in.
It's a guy, Patrick, he sort of develops all his own... plugins.
Is it?
Yeah.
I wasn't even too sure.
A lot of them are free, aren't they?
Yeah, these are all free, actually, yeah. And that's just a delay. And you've got, like, a lot of different options there for delay. And they're really good sounding. The reverb is also good. There's, like, even proper synths that they do here. Don't they? Little simple enough synths, but you can get good sounds out of them. Yeah, I'd recommend those anyway, those Tal. Is that what they're actually called, yeah?
Toga Audio Line, I think, is
the... All right, Toga Audio Line, yeah. And there's, like, I think I got them all free on the same page. Someone else put them up, and they work very good if you're not happy with the built-in kind of...
Good stuff. I think it was the Flandry released recently was really good.
Yeah.
Some nice stuff. Any other ones?
Yeah, there's a few more. Cosmic Artistry wanted to know, do you mix using headphones?
Do I mix tracks?
Yeah.
Usually not. Sometimes I'll use them just as another kind of way of, you know, you might hear something, you might think something's far too loud in the headphones and it might sound okay in the speakers, so you need to find kind of a middle ground. So I do a bit of both,
just a bit of extra reference in
exactly. Yeah.
And would you create a track with headphones or do you always try and do it
well
with your speakers?
No, sometimes, you know, if you're away and that's all you've got. But I never, like, I'd have to go back and listen to it because it all sounds different on headphones for me.
Yeah.
Okay, and James X. Arnold's come back and said, thanks for the last answer. He wanted to know about your thoughts process when creating a song. I know you mentioned about the melody, but he was wanting to know if you any way in particular that you go about it.
Well, it depends. Yeah, see, it depends where you start from. Because, you know, if you start off you might sample a bit of percussion or something like that, get a bit of a loop going, and that might take you off in a really kind of drum-orientated way. Or if I start off with a melody, I mightn't add the drums till later, you know? So it really depends where you start from. Usually I'll start off with a melody. It's kind of hard, yeah.
Okay,
you try and build a melody from one part, you know, and try to add to that. Or if I have, like, a sample, try and work from that, you know, build everything around that. Or else it depends where you start from, really.
Cool. So. Any more?
Okay, yeah, there's loads more, actually. what analog synth that you don't own would you like to own? And that's from Anna X.
Probably a Korg Triton, I'd say. I'm looking at getting one of those. They're really good, and the sounds are great out of them. So
nice strings.
Yeah, really nice strings and pads and stuff like that.
Davey and Paul use it on there.
Yeah. And
any sort of pure analog sort of. I mean, I think Triton's a sort of sample bass. Well, right. It's got a bit of both sort of virtual analog and.
Yeah, well, I'd love to get a 909, but I don't know if there's any point at this stage. But maybe I'll see. Or even an 808, I'd like to get, yeah.
Cool.
Sean from Dublin was wondering what all do you have in your studio, equipment-wise?
What's that, sorry?
What equipment would you have in the studio?
Basically, I just had my laptop, MIDI keyboard, a couple of analog bits like Nord Lead, Mofo, and speakers. That's about it, really, at the moment. But, you know, I'm kind of building it. I will be building it all the time as well, so.
And, are you interested in maybe going for an analog desk, or would you want to keep it all in the computer?
At the moment, I don't really feel the need for it, you know. I'm kind of happy enough the way I'm doing it at the moment, but that might change. It might get really, you know, it just depends what happens, I suppose, you know.
I need to go back and check the internet again soon, but I've got one more at the moment, which is, if there's any club that you haven't played yet that you'd really like to play in, what would it be?
Any club?
Yeah.
Probably like Panorama Bar Berlin or Womb in Tokyo, I'd say.
Have you been out to it?
No, never. No.
Not even as a punter?
No, but all I hear about it, I've, you know, loads of people that I know have gone there and just like raving about it all the time. So,
how do you go about getting your gigs?
People just contact me basically, like, and
do you find if you get signed to a particular label that you get gigs through that process, or is it?
Not particularly, no.
And would you sign a track to a particular label on the off chance that they, you know, would be, or they do have a club or something like that? You know, would you be thinking about that, or is it, you know,
not really? No, not really. No, you generally try and sign stuff to labels that I like, you know, as much as I can. Obviously, sometimes, you know, you mightn't be able to release it on the kind of label you want, but another label is really into it, so just depends.
Cool. Any more, Sandra? Can we get one over the...
And a massive sea of music, obviously, you come across now. What, in your opinion, makes a great track that makes it stand out to you personally?
I think I always kind of go for something that has usually a lot of melody and an atmosphere, you know, or if it just makes you kind of want to dance or whatever like that. If they've got like two or three of those elements, I think for me they're always going to really work, you know. It's like, well, I like generally kind of moody stuff, you know, but you know, hear something with a dark atmosphere and like some cool melody, that I'll usually be into that kind of stuff. So
good stuff. Well, I think we're going to wrap it up now. Thanks everyone for coming. Thanks very much, Ian O'Donovan.
Thanks for having me. Thanks for coming.
Cheers, and we'll catch you all soon.